Hello, everyone.
Wow, what a great turnout, a great conference, and above all, great food. But last but not least, thanks for the beers. So with that said, my name is Samir Dixit. I'm the senior director for Spiron Security Labs. We provide a bunch of services in cybersecurity space. And for today's topic, I'm going to talk about what does it mean for blockchain and cybersecurity. So let's get started. So for today's agenda, we'll quickly touch upon what's a blockchain. I think you guys have heard it several times, so you'll be fine with it, even if I skip over it. What are some of the current use cases? What blockchain means for cybersecurity? Some of the security challenges around blockchain. And then what are some of the solutions or things that you can implement to be a secure organization? And then in between, we'll probably have some trivia things for you. So what's a blockchain? Blockchain is a distributed ledger that groups transactions and records in blocks of data. But the three key factors there are, it does it with confidentiality, integrity, and availability. So remember that. So just a little bit of a history on blockchain. It was sort of the concept was first came out with Satoshi Nakamoto-san having a white paper out on Bitcoin, a peer-to-peer electronic cash systems, and that's when it went sort of viral. And then we stand today with tons and tons of use cases around it, from anywhere from financial services, healthcare, patient records, automotive is actually getting into it with car sharing, as well as mobility services, identity management, you name it, and some of the speakers that have come before me, they have talked about how creatively they are using blockchain in solving different problems. So what are the key objectives for any cryptography? Three fundamentals. It's a CIA triad that, if you know, it's not the same CIA that cracks on criminals. It's confidentiality, integrity, and availability. Confidentiality, that data is available to authorized user in a confidential manner. Only an authorized user should be able to assess it or access it. Integrity, only an authorized user is able to make changes to it, and there is a traceability that he or she made the change. Availability, that it is the data is available to an authorized user at any given point in time. So now let's talk about some of the risks that cybersecurity has on the basic fundamentals of blockchain, which was built on CIA, starting with confidentiality. So as we go towards particularly in a private blockchain, right, protecting that blockchain network access is fundamental in securing the data access. Why? Because it's common saying, if you can get to my network, you can get to my data. So that's an issue. Security risk number two, and this is sort of an eye chart. If you can read all through that in 5 seconds I have, I will give you another t-shirt. But again, talking about integrity, if you look at blockchain, blockchain has the characteristics of immutability and traceability, which does provide it a means of data integrity. But the same cannot be said for things like smart contracts that are using that. These are programs, software programs, that allow for a straight-through processing of and interacts with other smart contracts. What's the issue with that? Have you guys not heard of software being breached? Have you not heard of softwares being hacked? So and it would be a domino effect because these smart contracts are linked with one another. So if one goes down, there would be ripple effects of it on implementation of it, all the language itself that has been created. Last but not least, the availability. Internet has been sort of being plagued very recently with all DDoS type of attacks. Either it's for the disruption of internet, disruption of services, and so that we are all the blockchain implementations that are also connected to this backbone, we could have the same cripple effect of that into our own implementation in terms of availability. So what can we do? With that, I'm going to actually pass the mic to Tej, who's going to talk about some of the recent learnings that we have made by assessing some of your peers, especially in the blockchain industry. So we get called for whenever there are incidents, so we provide incident services. We do also do proactive testing for some of the blockchain industry where either they are getting ready for their ICO. Because again, one of the things that I do want to stress is, until you get to that ICO stage, you're not really a main target for an attacker, because at that time you're a concept. But once you are an ICO, there is a value in it that kind of like raises the interest for an attackers. So with that, I'll transfer it over to Tej.
Thank you, Samir. So as you can see, security is always an afterthought. That's why we're 7 o'clock in the evening. And that's what we've seen in the industry. So can you guys clap on that, please? I just have a quick question for all you guys. What is the number one threat factor in the cybersecurity industry, and that applies to blockchain as well? Insider attack. That's the number one threat in every cybersecurity breach that we've seen, and also in the blockchain space. Michael Pickler was earlier speaking here. I don't know, who's read the Looting the Fox? Has anybody read Looting the Fox? Looting the Fox. Shapeshift was a, they had an insider breach. Oh, yeah. There's a whole detail article. It's actually very impressive. Read up on it. I think it will help you guys in your assessment or going forward how you implement cybersecurity. So the slide that's behind me doesn't apply to what I'm going to tell you because you've seen enough slides. So what I'm going to just talk about is more of the use cases. We're working, like Samir said, we work with some of your peers in the blockchain space. Unfortunately, we get involved when usually there's after a breach. So what I'm going to talk about is normally what you should be doing, and from a best practices perspective, prior to having a breach. It's from what we've seen, it's a wild, wild west. It's any startup. Security is usually an afterthought. There's some processes and procedures around it that we need to have some secure processes. We need to, there's only 5 people in our team. We can handle it. But as the team grows, as you add more people, as you do an ICO, as you go public, the threat vector keeps on increasing. And some of the threats that you don't even realize that they're in your environment that you need to be able to mitigate those. So one of the kind of the key best practices we do when we go for any security assessment is a threat modeling. So I will recommend and ask all you guys to do a threat modeling. Understand what are your threats, whether that's physical, that's people, that's external to the internet, or any, what is your threat around the application or the system you're developing. And what are your threats around that? In terms of, and have some risk prioritization to those threats. Next step that we do usually is more of a security architecture review. So I would recommend everybody look at your architecture, whether there's an application, whether in terms of your infrastructure, what are the things you're deploying? Kind of the key concern we see in all your blockchain space is that it's cloud hosted. There's a lot of third-party applications being used, a lot of open source systems being in place, and it's obviously there. It's new, so people don't have the experience. There's only certain teams that have the experience that they can do the development. There's only a few teams that they are working with everybody, and everybody's scrambling to figure out how they can deploy the next best thing out in the market. After security architecture review, we recommend doing a source code review for your smart contracts, for your website you're developing, for your ICO. Like Samir said, once you go in ICO, your public interface, their threat vector increases significantly. So the next process we usually do is a cryptographic review of your private keys, your hashes, any cryptographic process around the whole application or your a blockchain deployment, the complete cryptographic review of that process. And the next after that is more of a traditional application security that needs to be in place. If you have a web application, needs to be done a thorough pen testing of the web application from any phishing attacks. Someone did mention phishing earlier, any injection attacks, anything in terms of your authentication mechanisms, anything around that application, how it interacts with the backend server and the end user. What we're seeing in the space is there's Cloudflare, there's there's the different web application firewalls in place, but they're completely configured in a way that they're vulnerable to even not even a sophisticated hacker. The next part is basically doing a more of a red team exercise activities, which includes your security testing of your infrastructure, physical security around the building, and in terms of your wireless connections, any connections that you have in the building. So that needs to be all security testing and see who can spoof the data that's being interacted, who can get in, what are the user training in and security policy reviews for your users in the team, and as well as the people that you interact with, what data they can have access to, what privileges they need, how they access, what audit process you have around it. So all that needs to be in place. So in terms of kind of overall recommendation is that there needs to be a proactive approach to security before you even go ICO. And like I said, majority of the companies we're dealing with, we're finding out that they've been breached after either somewhere in the ICO or after ICO. So this is some of the recommendations. Within the limited time, Samir and I are available afterwards. We'll share our information. Please feel free to just reach out to us. We'll answer any questions. It doesn't have to be that have to provide a paid information. We'll provide information that's available in the market. There's a lot of information available, how you can secure, you can have a secure process in place. Thank you.
So how come he got the clap and I didn't? That's why I'm back again. So why we are here, right? As I said, before you go to ICO, or if you are in ICO and you're the unfortunate ones who get hacked, Spiron can provide a landing hand in terms of making sure the risks get mitigated, you're secure again, as well as also help you get to having secure processes and applications and things in place. Above all, I did talk about DDoS, right? So it's very important to make sure that you have IDS, IPS, and firewalls in place. If you don't have those, that's the first step. Once you have them, then also it's important that you get like a third party to validate that the rule sets that you have on it, can those be bypassed? The configurations that you have done for your IDS and IPS, are they bulletproof? Because what we have seen, as Tej mentioned, most of the companies that we go in and they get breached, we ask them, do you have IDS, IPS? They're like, yes, we have. But they have configured their firewalls with the default username and passwords that it came out of the box with. That's not gonna help you. So, and again, I mean, attackers out there are inventive. So you might have blocked a particular signature, but they are trying different variants of it, and we can help you with those. So we could help you with anything from your network, making sure your private network is secure. You are using applications and mobile applications for your users to actually interact with your systems. Those are, again, an attack surface that could bring lots of attacks into your organization. So those needs to be secure as well. And we could provide an assessment of your applications and mobile applications to tell you where the vulnerabilities are and provide you remediations. Last and not least, as they said, he actually leads the software architecture team, so he can come in and do a full-on threat analysis, threat vectors, and have his team come in and tell you which are some of the issues that you have in your code that could lead to a next buffer overflow attack or any injection sort of attacks or phishing attacks. So with that said, thank you. If you have any questions, please come back after the talk, and I'll be happy to give you my contact information. You can reach us at securitylabs@spirent.com, and this also has Tage and my email IDs if you want to reach us directly. And enjoy the show. Thanks very much.